don't know me, my name is Trevor Mays. I'm the president of this university's chapter of Pi Sigma Alpha, which is, for those of you who don't know that, it is the National Honor Society for Political Science students. It's based out of Washington, D.C., and their grant this year, we applied for their grant, and that's what's making this event happen right now. Also, big thanks to the university and the Student Activities Department for helping put this event on, as well as Chartwell's for catering the event. Everyone, if you haven't already seen the refreshments in the back, take an opportunity to go grab some food. The only thing, we do have a mask policy still in order on this campus, so just kind of try to stay spaced out a little bit if you do grab food. And most importantly, thank you to Mr. Candelora and Mr. Rojas for taking time out of their busy schedules at the Connecticut General Assembly to come and speak to you all today. All right, so now to introduce a special guest who we're very excited to have this afternoon, University President Nelson Nunez.
Thank you, Trevor. We haven't had many face-to-face events. You're sort of breaking the record. And I was freezing walking over, and I said, oh my God, it's still winter, we won't let go. But we're just honored that you're here today, and how grateful we are that you've taken the time in the middle of a legislative session to come and talk with us and help us think through some of these complicated issues. Thank you. So I want to welcome everybody today to today's debate, and thank you for being here. As I said, everybody's really busy this time of year, so we just welcome your participation. I want to first of all thank Professor Martin Mendoza and other faculty members from the Political Science, Philosophy, and Geography Department. These faculty members are fabulous, the way they support their students. They care deeply about them, and they're very committed, and we need to thank them. I also want to thank Trevor Mays, who's president of our campus's Alphabeta Gamma chapter of Pi Sigma Alpha, as he said, and it's the National Honor Society for political science students. Many of these students will go on to law school. Every once in a while, we have political science students going to medical school, too. and they go on to get great jobs. We're very proud of all of you. Trevor and his fellow students successfully applied for a grant from the National Pi Sigma Alpha organization to support this event. So they were very entrepreneurial. They know that we have limited funds, but they went out there and got funding. So thank you, Trevor, for showing that leadership. I especially want to thank House Minority Leader Vincent Candelora and House Majority Leader Jason Rojas for taking time from their busy schedules to visit this campus. It's an honor and a privilege to have you both here. Minority Leader Candelora is a Republican and Majority Leader Rojas is a Democrat. I don't think they will be offended when I call them stellar politicians, for it is through the political process that legislative representatives are elected and they become the voice of the people. They are, these two men are the voice of the people, so we listen to them very carefully. But have no doubt, both our guests are faithful public servants working on behalf of every citizen of Connecticut, regardless of their political party. I know they disagree on a number of issues, and that's fine. We will hear from them directly on that. We'll learn from them today. But they also work together in their chambers to improve the quality of our life, each one of us, in our state. So we are very grateful to them for that. When you listen to or you read the transcriptions of the discussions, or you see them live, you realize how they enact our democracy. They make it work by their participation, and that's what makes this a great state. I'm excited to have our legislative leaders on campus today in sharing their viewpoints and information on the latest legislative issues facing the Connecticut Assembly. They are helping each of us, especially our students, learn firsthand how the legislative process works in a democratic society. The ability to disagree, to have rigorous yet civil discussions and debates on matters of public interest is at the very heart, the foundation of a democratic self-government. And we are proud, as I said, that they are here to answer questions and to engage us in these discussions. Our students do the same thing in our Student Government Association. I stress that just as Eastern students talk about issues that impact their life on campus, they also talk about topics that are important to the people of Connecticut. They do that all the time and they do it well. They also pay attention to national and international matters that are equally important to be discussed on our campus. When I go to the accounting banquet, I always say to the accounting students, we don't graduate accountants at Eastern. We graduate liberally educated people that happen to be accountants. And the students get very excited. They can debate the conflict in the Middle East. They can debate the role of religion in this country. They can talk about the gaps in our society in an intelligent way. And that's why Connecticut chose Eastern to be its only public liberal arts college. We live that mission every day, and that is a mission at the heart of it is critical thinking, developing your critical thinking skills and systematic logic skills. That is why I'm hopeful that today's debate will stimulate further discussion on campus regarding issues of public interest. In addition to preparing students for professional careers, I can think of no more important outcome of a liberal arts college, liberal arts education, than ensuring that our students understand what it means to be a citizen in this great country. What is happening now in the Ukraine, for instance, is of interest to all of us because we understand how connected all nations are in the 21st century and how fragile the balance is that holds us together. So again, I thank Representative Candelora and Rojas for sharing your time with us, and especially thank you for all that you do for our state. Thank you.
Thank you, President Nunez. Now I'd like to introduce Jorge Centeas, who is going to be a sort of moderator for this afternoon's discussion. It's going to be not really quite a debate format. Right side of the room, we have a microphone set up where you're going to be able to ask questions. And I think that's going to be more what everyone's interested in and more of the big section of this event. So take it away, guys.
Yeah, so Mr. Rojas and Mr. Candelora will be discussing on a wide array of topics. And like Trevor said, if at any point you guys have a question, please feel free to ask. These might have the answers to. And at the end of the discussion, you can also have a line. We'll have a line up there at the mic, so you'll be free to ask questions then as well. So, please.
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here at Eastern and to be able to engage you, talk a little bit about what we do up in Hartford. I was also a product of the liberal arts. Education, and I think it is a wonderful thing to have to help you all think critically going forward. I represent the House Republican Caucus. I've served there for 15 years representing North Brantford, parts of Wallingford, Guildford, and Durham. I was elected to be leader approximately about a year ago, and I think as part of that sort of background of having that type of education, We certainly try to work collaboratively across both sides of the aisle. The structure in Hartford is very similar on the federal level when it comes to having our committee meetings, deliberation, and bills that go to the House and Senate. But I think we function very differently in that it's a smaller chamber, there is a lot more conversation. So while we have disagreements on different issues, we always try to have those debates and those disagreements because the end product comes out so much better. And so even if there's legislation that I may not support in the end, there could be some impact that I have on making sure that legislation is crafted in the best it could be. And so Representative Rojas and I, our responsibilities are sort of quarterbacking our members and having those kind of conversations, both the substance and the strategy of how to work together. And so we'd be happy to talk a little bit about that and some of the issues that are facing us this session.
Thank you, Vinny, Representative Candelora, I'm calling Vinny because that's what we call each other, Vinny and Jason. So feel free to address us that way too. But so thank you so much for having me here today. It's great to be back on Eastern's campus. I haven't probably been here since the late 90s when I was an undergraduate student at UConn, and we would come visit here for whatever reason we would come and visit. So it's great to be back. And great to see the investment that the state of Connecticut has made in our education campuses, particularly in the form of all these beautiful buildings, which were not here when I was here back in the late 1990s, and UConn certainly didn't look the way it looks now when I was there too. So really great to see the outcome of all that investment, which is really investment in all of you, whether you're a student, whether you're staff, whether you're a member of the faculty. All of that is an investment in the future of all of you as citizens, certainly, and in the future of our state. And you know, I wanna focus on that word citizen when we think about liberal arts education. Outside of politics, I've worked in higher education for 20 years. I'm currently the chief of staff to the president of Trinity College, which is a small private liberal arts school. So I very much am a believer in the liberal arts in terms of producing citizens, and not just the citizens who happen to be an accountant, who happen to be a lawyer, who happen to be a politician, who happen to be a business owner. Because that's certainly what that world, the world needs right now, is people who can think critically, be able to listen to the other side, but also communicate effectively. And I think those are really the major tenets of liberal arts education, and I'm grateful that Eastern is here providing it to all the students that are here. And you know, and Vinny talked about it, actually. I was just getting off the phone with my chief of staff, because part of the process at the Capitol that's taking place right now, which is really inside baseball, is called this process called screening, which is where my team of deputies, Vinny's team of deputies, they spent the last week reading every single bill that got voted out of committee. And on a weekly basis, we will review all those bills. His team will do that, my team will do that, then we'll get together actually and talk about and compare notes and talk about where a bill needs to get referred to next, if it needs to go to another committee, or whether a bill should go to the floor of the House. We'll have our own notes, his team will have their notes, we compare them, and then we compromise and we negotiate about what we're gonna do with all the various pieces of legislation. So I think that speaks to how much collaboration actually takes place in our state government here in Connecticut. I don't know that the same can be said for federal government. And I don't know that the same could be said for many other states around the country, but you know, I'm proud of the fact, and I say it as often as I can, actually I said it on the floor of the House last week. If you look at any of our mining committee's voting record, Minority Leader, Majority Leader, we probably vote together 85-90% of the time on a bipartisan or near unanimous basis. Now that 10-15% of the things we don't agree on, those are big, big issues, and they're really important issues, whether it's budget, whether it's criminal justice, whether it's some of the social issues that we're grappling with. But even when we do disagree, there's a level of respect that is always maintained for each other as human beings first and politicians second. And you know, this is partisan politics, and we both have a role to play in advancing the political interests of our party. But more often than not, I don't think it's really appreciated enough. We actually put the people of Connecticut before either of our party when we choose to act on laws. So I'm really proud to be a member of the General Assembly. I've been there since my 14th year, so I came in just after Vinny did. We were both on the Finance Committee. I was on the Finance Committee for 12 years prior to becoming Majority Leader, just like he did about a year ago. I was elected by my colleagues to be Majority Leader, and in that role, it's really about managing the legislative process, as I explained through the screening process, and then managing the floor operation when we're in session. And even during session days, I'm often on the phone with Vinny from across the chamber, talking about what bills are gonna come up next, how much time are we gonna dedicate to debate, where can we compromise, can we do some of their bills, can we do some of our bills. And more often than not, him and his members have a whole lot of good ideas that help some of the policy goals that we have make them even better. We often don't want to admit that because we don't want to give them credit, but we will take their ideas and put them into our bills, and then even sometimes we'll take their ideas and they still have to vote no, and I understand that. But what matters at the end of the day is that we get to a good policy product out there that improves all of your lives and everybody across the state of Connecticut. So with that, I think I'll leave it at that for opening remarks, and I'm hoping that you didn't expect to come here and listen to two politicians talk at you for an hour. We're hoping that you guys have lots of questions for us that we can answer for you. We're going to start calling on people in a minute, so. Who wants to go first? We can start with higher ed related bills. I know we exchanged texts. I know there's one bill out there right now that would seek to end legacy admissions. So basically, not allowing institutions of higher education to take into account whether you have a parent or a family member attend the school, and whether that should factor into whether you get admitted into an institution of higher ed or not. I guess I'll throw that out there to the crowd just to hopefully get the conversation started when you see somebody go up to the microphone. And you can be about anything in that legacy admissions, unless you're the dean of enrollment.
Not an issue for us. So I'm a professor of political science here. My name is Nicole Krasitz. Thank you both very much for coming. The question I have for you pertains to a class I'm teaching. So I'm teaching a class this semester on with another faculty member on COVID-19 politics and federalism, so that relationship between national and state governments. And several of the students from this class are here. So I'd love for you to be able to speak from your perspective about the challenges in making policy at the state level you face because of things coming down from on high from the federal government. Thank you.
Yeah, I think it has been an interesting issue that we've been hit with in Connecticut. Even when it came to whether or not to reopen businesses and when to open schools, you know, the CDC recommendations, I think it started with the management of the virus and to what degree do we step away from what the federal government is recommending. But I think most recently now, one of our issues that we're facing is all the federal money that's come in, the ARPA dollars, has certainly made pretty much every state flush with cash in the short term. But part of that that money comes with strings attached. So one of the areas is to what degree we can provide tax relief to our citizens. And as we're faced with rising inflation, we're faced with higher food costs, higher gas costs, there is a debate now of to what extent and to what areas do we want to provide tax relief to sort of offset that inflation. And that I think will become not just a partisan battle, but also a battle between chambers and between the governor's office. Everybody has a different philosophy on how that money potentially should be used because it's limited resources. So whether it's a property tax credit or sales tax reduction or a child tax credit, that has sort of put that battle, for lack of a better word, but put those issues into the mix.
Yeah, at the outset, right, President Trump at the time kind of left it to the states to kind of manage their responses to the overall, right, to the acute things on the ground. It was really left to states. Obviously, the federal government played a key role in trying to provide resources, get together PPE or testing supplies, and obviously dedicating a significant amount of financial resources for the states to help them respond to the pandemic. So obviously here in Connecticut, there was a lot of debate about the governor calling for executive powers and issuing an emergency declaration which allowed the governor to have these extraordinary powers to help lead the state through the pandemic. And throughout that process, I think there was a lot of difficulty on both sides. Obviously, the Democrats supported the governor's request to extend his emergency authority a number of times. Republican colleagues supported that at the outset too, but then began to think that we should move some of that decision-making authority back into the legislature. A part of me actually agreed with that, right? I did think that the legislature could do more to be part of that process, but at the same time, I also understood that the governor needs to respond to things very quickly. We are a part-time legislature. I don't know what percentage, a significant percentage of us have a job outside of politics. Trying to coordinate schedules for 151 members in the House, 26 members in the Senate, is more of a challenge than people can appreciate. I oftentimes people are like, that's not an excuse, right? Scheduling a meeting. But it is very difficult, right, in ensuring that all elected members of the General Assembly can actually participate in the process, knowing that they have a lot of external pressures applied to them, whether it's their family or whether it is their job outside of politics, made that process a bit more difficult for us. But I think we've done a really good job as a state in managing the response to the pandemic. There's all sorts of data points that you can look at to say we've done worse here versus another state, we've done better here versus another state. I think all in all, overall, we've done a good job of managing this, but it wasn't without a lot of sacrificing kind of my own values and my own perspectives about what the role of the legislature should be and what my role as a duly elected member of the legislature should be, particularly as a legislative leader. But here we are at a much better place, right? We're moving in the direction of normalcy returning. I mean, we all know that there's the stealth variant that's out there now. We're beginning to see cases increase again. And what does that mean for all of us as citizens of this state? What does it mean for us as members of a college community? I've managed a COVID response at Trinity for the last 2 years, and I can tell you on behalf of all the faculty and staff who have made these difficult decisions on behalf of all of you, it is really, really difficult work to do. Just because, like in politics and the people that we represent, I have a certain amount of people in my district who don't agree with an issue. I have a certain amount of people in my district who are for an issue. And it's the same here on a college campus. lots of constituents for your president. I often equate being a president of a college of being like an elected official or governor. You have all of these various stakeholder groups who all want to do something their own way. And then you have faculty who have different interpretations about what it means about shared governance and decision making on their campus. And that brings its own set of challenges. And you have students, you have parents, you have donors, you have alumni, you have the community, you have all sorts of people asking you to do one thing or another. And often we have to make a decision that is based on our experience, based on our understanding of the situation, and that is in the best interest of the most amount of people at any given time. And I think that's what we did for the most part in responding to COVID. To Vinny's point about the all significant financial resources that have come in here, they're limited in their use. They do have an end date at some point. What happens with the funding or the programs that we decide to fund? What happens after those funds run out? And I think that's a big question that looms for all of us. I'm a bit more hesitant to look at the tax cutting side of things, not because I'm a liberal Democrat, but because we have a lot of long-term issues that we have to deal with and will require resources. And if we put a tax cut in now, that feels temporary or is temporary in nature, what does that say to the taxpayer when we have to go back and perhaps increase taxes to try to fund some of the services that are really important to us?
And I think to piggyback while I'm thinking of different programs, a lot of the ARPA money that the state got in that we're administering, it does not really have strings attached other than how much tax relief you can give. But there are pockets of money that flow directly from the federal government to state agencies. Like for instance, there's an assistance program that's given to people who might get into financial trouble. If they qualify for their homes, they can get up to $30,000 in order to help them pay down their mortgage debt. And that program expands out into 2026. So it's sort of interesting, it circumvents the state of Connecticut budget. It does create a policy in our state, to what degree we're going to provide somebody assistance for their homes and avoid foreclosures that we don't have any sort of input on. I mean, obviously, in the short term, this assistance is necessary, but it is already slated to flow out to, I think it's 2025. It's somewhere around $125 million, so it's a pretty significant program that will change, overall will change the way the foreclosure market operates because I believe it can stop the foreclosure while they're getting the funding. Those are sort of, one of the things that COVID did do is it allowed the feds to kind of sweep in and create those policies that we don't even debate in the chamber.
My name is Jim Bellano. I'm the Economic and Community Development Director for the town of Linden. And first, we as a town appreciate your investment in Eastern Connecticut State. We try and work closely with President Munoz on a lot of issues, and we're always trying to build that relationship. And Zach Corey is an intern in my office this year, and I see you already have a former intern here. So we're always looking to build on that. My question is, from the town of Linden's perspective, a lot of the burden of funding government services at the municipal level falls on the local property tax. If you're a town like Linden, and I'm sure you've heard this, Governor East Hartford has the same questions. If you're a hub of social, educational, and human services, you tend to have a lot of properties that are tax exempt. Linden's grand list is about 48% tax exempt. So where do you see the legislature as kind of supporting towns to help fill that gap? Because we service Columbia, Cobham Street, Hampton, all the towns around us come to us for those services, yet we're the ones happily bearing the burden of that tax exemption status.
Yeah, but the primary way in which the state supports, which is very unique, because I don't know that there's another state that actually has what is called a college and hospital pilot program. Pilot being payment in lieu of taxes, right? So when properties are exempt from taxation and there's a section of the statutes, I forget the number, but it has probably 90 different exemptions. that says towns and cities cannot apply the property tax to these various things. They include higher education, both, well, obviously for Eastern is the state property, so it'd be kind of weird to tax a state property only. But then my employer, Trinity College, is also exempt, right? And this is universal across the country. There are no states that actually levy property taxes on nonprofits. There's fees and things like that that are attempted from time to time. But so we do reimburse the city of Windham for a percentage of the revenue that would otherwise realize if all of these beautiful buildings were taxable. It doesn't nearly fill the complete need that is there. But then, then becomes the question, if this wasn't here, what would be here? We don't know, right, whether that would be tax producing or not, or whether it would actually result in additional cost to the community of Windham if this was just another 2,000 houses with another 700 kids in the local schools at a cost of $13,000 a student. So there's a bit of give and take in that, and obviously there's a lot of economic development or economic activity that takes place with having students here who go to local restaurants, who go to local stores, who might work locally, who take Uber rides, right, to support local jobs or Uber drivers. So it's a give and take, but the primary way in which we support towns and cities is through that pilot program, which again, no other state has. Connecticut is unique in that it actually provides resources to municipalities. So often I will tell CCM and COST, our organizations of mayors and chief elected officials, I hear you, but you should also be grateful that we're the one state that's actually reimbursing you for at least part of the loss of that revenue.
Yeah, I think the pilot issue is been addressed, in Connecticut, debated last year.
Put $120 million more into it.
That's right. And we debated it and sort of rejiggered. And I think there's a lot of push and pull in our education systems in general for public schools in Connecticut are funded through local property taxes and then also through state grants. It's through the education cost formula. And so that education money that goes to our high schools and elementary schools also, it is argued that we, as a state, we don't fund that enough. And so there's always a push and pull between the pilot program that pays for our hospitals and universities, versus our high schools and intermediate schools, that local funding for education, and trying to find how to strike that balance. And it's just something that's always being debated. This year, the ECS formula is the target right now that we're having that conversation again, which is going to impact Eastern Connecticut, because when it was revised, the more rural communities, I think, got hurt in that formula versus our more densely populated ones.
Yeah, and that local education funding, that's $2 billion a year out of that $20 billion budget. So significant investment in towns and cities, which has the effect of limiting property tax increases, which don't have to worry about here, but for homeowners, you certainly know what I'm talking about.
So we have a few of issues, and I can throw out there. I think a lot that we hear about that's controversial, that we're hearing in the legislature, you may want to hear about, but one of the bills that we're addressing in public health is assisted suicide, whether or not somebody who's terminally ill would have the ability to be able to terminate their life by, going through a medical process, so a doctor. And it's an interesting issue that we continue to see rise up. And it's one of those areas that I think has some faith-based components. So we certainly see a lot of people from different faiths that come in and oppose that type of legislation. And then we have individuals that have been impacted with terminal illness, ALS or cancer. And so we just had our public hearings on that bill, which I think was almost 24 hours. It is a bill that isn't necessarily partisan, but I think both sides of the aisle, many members on both sides of the aisle have very passionate views about. And so as that works through the process, there's so many different components to it to look at. So on the one hand, we need to take a look at the doctor-patient relationship. How does it impact the Hippocratic Oath? Because a doctor is supposed to do no harm, and so they would actually be prescribing medication that would be able to, some would be able to terminate their life. So those issues need to be taken into consideration. The mental state, if we're going to go in that direction, what type of psychological evaluation should we make sure the patients go through, because they're making such a dramatic decision? what are the safeguards that you put in place for you know, spouses or loved ones, immediate family members that are helping to make that decision that might financially benefit if this person was, their lives were terminated, are there insurance policies? So then you get into the realm of, you know, looking at, you know, the ability for the state to investigate any type of wrongdoing that potentially arises out of that, and how does that work? And so a lot of these issues, I throw that one out there, it can get very politically charged, but there's so many underpinnings to that type of legislation that really puts legislators in tough positions on which way to support. And so when you read about it in the headlines, emotionally, it's a very easy decision to say somebody should be allowed to terminate their own life if they choose. But then when you start to try to craft a law, there's so many other factors that go into it that it's not such an easy answer. And I think as politicians, one of the things, and I'll use that word in this context, because it's one of the things that's difficult for us, how do we try to craft law to do the right thing? At the same time, you have to fight the political battle that you see, you know, that's sort of on the headlines. And that's something that we're always trying to navigate and help our caucus members out to sort of message and work through it. At the same time, we're trying to develop and craft legislation that can be very impactful to people's lives.
Yeah, I mean, and even how we frame it, how we talk about it. Assisted suicide, we like to look at it as aid in dying.
Right.
Right? And even the use of words in terms of how we frame the policy debate are very important, but also come from a place where that might reflect the actual position that you might take. And I think for proponents of the legislation, and I am a supporter of it, really, there really is no greater civil right or freedom that an individual can have about how to end their life and when to end their life when they are suffering from debilitating disease or an end-stage disease that they're dealing with. That is, I've never been in that position. I hope I'll never have to be in that position, but there are stories over the last 10 years that you hear about a spouse putting a gun into the hand of a loved one so that they can end their life. I don't know that that's the way we want these things to be carried out. We do know that there are people who go to other states to avail themselves. There are states that do allow for aid in dying decisions to be made, and we have people who go to other states, and it becomes a question for us about how do we empower our constituents to make these kind of very personal, emotional decisions in a way that is safe. I mean, that's one of the concerns that I have had. You get a lethal dose of medication that you now take home. Can it be left on a nightstand? Can it be left on a kitchen counter? Can a child in the house access that and then consume it and have another kind of tragedy? Those are very, very much things that really weigh on me. I tend to approach this job in a very secular way and not try to impose my religious beliefs into my policy decisions, but that's not how everybody does this job. And it's one of those issues that it doesn't cut cleanly across Republicans and Democrats. There are people in both our chambers who are on both sides of that issue. And will apply whatever their life experience they have or personal beliefs that they may have to a decision like that. But it's no doubt a difficult one, and it's been debated, I feel like, every year that I've been in the legislature. It only got out of committee for the first time last year. It did get out of committee this year. For me, it's to be seen as to whether either chamber will take final action on it.
I'd like to ask a question about the DACA. First of all, I want to thank both of you for the bipartisan support that the students got from both parties, especially around financial aid for the Connecticut was on the forefront of that. Many states are just, Colorado's just debating it now, and Arizona's just debating it now. Years ago, they came together on behalf of the students. So most people believe that very little or no immigration reform can happen before the midterm elections. So the idea of the DACA students getting any kind of, you know, relief in an immigration bill is probably not likely. They also believe that the Supreme Court decision that should come out in June would render their conditions very unacceptable here in this country. That means that we'd have 1 million college students without standing in this country. concerned, what are we going to do? We have hundreds here. Every college and university in Connecticut has DACA students. They came when they were babies. You know, they're more American than anyone, they feel, and they don't know what to do. So do you have any advice for the students as to how they can, you know, use their political capital to help these students?
Yeah, I mean, there have been glimmers of hope at the federal level that, you know, immigration reform could be done on a bipartisan basis. They've gotten close with the Gang of Eight, the Gang of Ten, the Gang of whatever, where it's equal number of Democrats, equal number of Republicans coming together to try to do something on immigration, which is long overdue. It's clear that, you know, the United States has always been a place that has welcomed people from all over the world who are just seeking out a better tomorrow, who are trying to escape violence, who are trying to escape religious persecution. I think we should remain that country that opens our doors to people from all over the world. But we also have a system that is very broken. And you know, you have people who are coming here out of desperation and having to wait 5, 6, 7, 10 years to actually get through a process so that they can have legal standing in this country. Unfortunately, like many things, it's fallen prey to the terrible politics that take place at the federal level. And, you know, they're not easy here at the state level, but there's certainly the debates are done in a much more humane way, in an understanding way, than they are at the federal level, where this issue often just becomes politically weaponized. And, you know, with, you know, elections taking place every 2 years, where you have House members and Senate members who are up and, you know, face the challenge of having ads run against them that all they care about is drug dealer, illegal aliens who are coming here to kill our families. When we know that the vast majority of the people who are coming to this country are not that. They are women, they are children, they are people here, are coming here to try to fill important jobs that, quite frankly, Americans don't want to fill. It's a real difficult thing to do, and I'm not trying to make excuses for our federal members of Congress. But that's where it is. It is so politically toxic that I don't know that we can ever arrive at a solution to it, which is really unfortunate for the future of this country, because we need immigration. We are not producing enough children on our own here. We need immigration of people for our economy to remain the greatest economy in the world. And until we get at that, you know, I unfortunately don't have a lot of hope.
Yeah, I think when the legislation was passed in Connecticut, to extend benefits, it's one of the concerns is, and I felt like in 08 it was more, 2008 it was more apt to begin to happen that we would see significant immigration reform federally, and that still hasn't happened. And so it's a tough answer, and I don't think I have any better one of an answer. I think most of our delegation supports reform. And it's a matter of continuing the advocacy to reach out to our federal delegation to try to push forward some level of reform. And it is unfortunate. It sort of gets back to, you know, just why I brought up the bill assisted suicide, compassionate care. When it gets politicized, it becomes that much harder to try to penetrate. But hopefully, if people keep up their advocacy and it starts becoming real for all of these millions of students, that you'll see some action.
We just got a DACA student admitted to Harvard Medical School full ride. These are very smart young people.
Yeah, we need our business community, I think, to speak up more, because they rely on these individuals who come to this country too for their workforce. And you know, I think they try to they stay a little quieter because they're worried about actually, in many cases, they're breaking the law or contributing to the breaking of law. So it's difficult for a lot of our business, major businesses. You know, I'm talking about food production, construction, those types of folks. You know, they're just trying to lay low and produce, you know, the chicken that we all eat in the dining hall. But there are a lot of undocumented individuals who are working on those food lines and ensuring that our food system is actually maintained.
My name is Martín Mendoza-Otila. I'm also a professor in the Department of Political Science here at Eastern. I'm sorry to drag you back to the economic side of the conversation. With COVID and the situation globally, trade, the U.S. has been experiencing a slowdown, an economic slowdown that is affecting different states in different ways. I have a two-part question. So the first part of the question would be, what is your impression of the overall economic health of the state of Connecticut? Obviously, the health of the government of the state of Connecticut is tied to the overall economic health of the, you know, the private sector in the state, all the industry that we have. We are much more service-oriented type of economy than other states. So first, what is your take? Are you more optimistic about the different scenarios? Do you think we're going to be able to weather the storm and start rebuilding, perhaps a short-term versus more long-term issue? So if you're more optimistic or pessimistic about our short-term economic evolution. And the second one, some of the institutions that have been affected severely by COVID and these financial downturns are educational institutions throughout the state. My question is, like, how strong your commitment, when I say your commitment as the legislature, is to help these institutions to weather the storm. I know that there are different needs, infrastructure, environmental plans, and so on, but how much of a priority is going to be help these institutions to, you know, reestablish a solid public education at that level?
Yeah, I think in terms of the overall economy of Connecticut, we probably were feeling better a year ago. And as we're moving forward, I think everyone's getting a little bit nervous. My family has a manufacturing business, and then we have a recreation and sports business. And both of them have been impacted in very different ways, but somewhat similar. For me, for my recreation facility, it's very hard to get employees to even work. And so that caused a constriction on our operations where we just closed labor-intensive business. And then also the food pricing, I think, is impacting everybody. And our manufacturing side, it's very difficult right now for us to get our domestic materials. And so we've started to look into Europe and some other countries to try to get the materials that we're looking for. And everything is, the pricing is just increasing. And so I think we're faced with an evolution economically. There's going to be some winners and there's going to be some losers. And how we come out of this, I think, is going to be a challenge. Meeting with a company in Wallingford the other day who does $500 million a year in business, they're doing very well, and they were able to navigate through the economy, and they had similar challenges. So I think everybody is sort of holding their breath and trying to see where we go. Our budget overall, we are flush with money, but certainly our unfunded liabilities in the state of Connecticut still haunt us. And I think we all definitely see the downturn, I think, in student population. And I think a lot of that was impacted by COVID. Just anecdotally in my own community, I have seen a drop off of kids not going to college. Hopefully they'll reapply it later in life. So they graduated high school, they might take a year or two off and then apply to college, and that might help right our ship. But it certainly is at the forefront of our concerns.
Yeah, I mean, I often describe myself as annoyingly optimistic, but like, I'm an idealist without illusion, I guess is how I would approach it, right? So I always try to look and find the good in all the future, but I also understand there are significant headwinds that we face as a state in the form of our long-term liabilities that Vinny referenced, in terms of our aging workforce, in terms of the overall demographics of the state. We're one of the older states in the country. And something relevant to higher education, like I said, this will be the second time I said it, we're not having a lot of children here in the Northeast. So even in my job at Trinity, back in 2015, we began looking at the demographic cliff that faces higher education, particularly New England, as we see the overall number of college-age students continuing to decline through 2026. Then we hopefully will begin to see an uptick in the number of college-age individuals. And that's a challenge that we face. I mean, it's expensive here in the Northeast, and we have a declining overall population of students or people who are of age to go to college. That certainly forced a lot of institutions to look at the non-traditional students, so adult learners, but also people who are coming out of all of the disruption that we've experienced over the last 2 years and are looking to retrain, shift career paths, and that's an opportunity for all of us as institutions of higher ed to try to capitalize on. But I think the biggest worry for me are those long-term liabilities that we have hanging out there. There's a lot of opportunity we have around manufacturing and jobs. We have electric boat, which is just down the road, which has thousands of jobs that they're going to need to fill over the next couple of years. So of course, the aircraft in Stratford should be making a pretty significant announcement tomorrow about something that they're working on, which again is thousands of jobs. And then, of course, there's the supply chain that funds the Pratt & Whitney's, the electric boats, the Sikorsky's, all small manufacturers like Vinny's who have a lot of jobs too, and they're all struggling to find people to fill those jobs, which kind of brings higher education to this kind of existential crisis that we all face right now, in which a lot of people are questioning the value of a college degree versus the cost, when you can go out and get into a certificate program or a two-year program, get a degree, get a manufacturing job, and make 80, 90 grand right out the gate without having to assume debt and without having to spend 4 years of your time reading Shakespeare or whatever else it is you don't want to read at that given time because you're interested in something else. So, and coupled with that is, you know, the state and federal government have not done enough to support higher education, period. It's, we barely support our public institutions here in Connecticut. We give them the bare minimum. And we haven't increased financial aid at the federal level in how long? Right now, Congress is trying to get a $400 increase in the Pell Grant, which, you know, it really hasn't been increased in like 30 years. So, you know, and not for nothing, but institutions of higher education employ people who expect and should expect to have a salary increase sometime. Who have health insurance that are provided to them, have other benefits. So I know a lot of people often want to point at the institutions and just say, you're just taking our money and wasting it. No, our biggest cost, just like education in K-12, is personnel, it's human resources. And we have to pay those people adequately. Often people who have, on average, higher degree attainment than the general population, have gone out and got master's degrees or PhDs and made that investment. And you know, I think, believe logically that they should be compensated for that expertise. So we have a lot of those different tensions at play here and a lot of misunderstanding and questioning about the value of higher education, which I think is to the detriment of our country.
Hello, my name is Molly Fouché. I'm a social work major here at Eastern and I'm doing a communities project with the ACLU, specifically Anderson Curtis, who I have not spoken to. And we are lobbying for the collateral consequences bill, I believe it's 6474, that just got passed out of the Labor Committee. Firstly, I was just wondering if you read the bill, what your thoughts are on it, and secondly, how you plan to support those living with records seeking equal opportunity and employment.
What's the bill? Collateral consequences, 6474. Just so you know, as a matter of process, I don't really read bills until they get out of committee and end up on my computer. Because in any given year, there's like 3,000 bills that are proposed, and you can read them all. And at the end of the day, we're going to pass maybe 250 of them, right? So the process is really efficient at getting rid of legislation. So I can't say I've read that bill, but I am familiar with it. I've generally been supportive about trying to do what we can to provide individuals who have been involved with the criminal justice system an opportunity to rebuild their lives, whether that's in housing, whether that's employment, whether that's in higher education attainment. I think doing all we can do to reduce the barriers to those individuals who already face significant obstacles in rebuilding their life, I think is in the best interest of all of us, so that they, one, don't reoffend, or perhaps go back to the behaviors that resulted in them getting incarcerated in the first place. And then the collateral consequences of that is they often have family, they have children. They want to take care of their families, they want to take care of their children, and when individuals can't do that, all of us end up bearing the cost of that when we don't allow individuals to be able to be economically self-sustaining.
Yeah, I think I agree with that. In giving a little to the employer's side, I think there's some circumstances where someone's past activity should come into consideration when an employer is hiring. You know, for instance, just in like the daycare settings, if someone's committed, was a sexual predator, committed multiple crimes, you know, those type of issues should impact an employer who's hiring. Working with children, you know, that should be taken into consideration. So I think we've seen that bill under different forms. That seems to be where it gets stuck is to what degree do you give employers the flexibility? Do we enumerate certain carve-outs in the financial institution if somebody's been arrested for larceny? Should they go into that field or does the employer have a right to know? But I do generally agree with that notion that something that was done, 5 years ago, 6 years ago, especially at a younger age, shouldn't be impacting them for the rest of their life. And it is sort of the devil in the details of how you provide the most flexibility for the employer at the same time you're not preventing somebody from getting employment.
And there was a bill that was kind of similar along the same lines, but applied to higher ed. There was a bill there that wouldn't allow admissions offices to look into the criminal background of prospective students. I got the thing in my head, seems like a good idea. We want to provide people the opportunity to get a higher education. And then I began to think about, you know, the prevalence of sexual misconduct and sexual assault on our college campuses. And what if we have a prospective student who has gotten in trouble for sexually assaulting students while they were in high school? I would want to know that as an administrator, as a parent, I would want to know, or I would want to ensure that an institution can perhaps prevent a situation where we're placing perhaps a sexual predator in a residence hall, in the kind of situations that we see on the higher ed campuses. So it's not so always so easy of a decision to make.
Hi, I'm Billy Beaver, and I'm a business administration major here at Eastern. And I just wanted to know what the decision-making process at the state level when it comes to allowing businesses to have the freedom of deciding what regulations and mandates they have for like COVID-19.
So, I mean, during that was an interesting process when it started out early on, when the governor's making the decisions of how a business can operate. It really was sort of different. Special interest groups would lobby the governor's office and work sort of behind the scenes of trying to craft what is appropriate in each industry and what they can do and who could be an essential business. And I think at the beginning of the pandemic, the governor's office did a very good job of allowing businesses, manufacturing was deemed essential. So to avoid disruption in the supply chain, they were allowed to operate under COVID. And I think it helps sort of navigate a pathway of what we could live with and what we could live without in COVID, what was high risk activity and what was low risk activity. So as it progressed, the governor's office was able to make decisions of what businesses, in particular restaurants, they were the slowest to reopen because it was deemed a higher risk activity. And we transitioned to outdoor dining as an alternative. And that was something I think the industry proposed, well, let us eat outside, it's safe. And so you saw that kind of give and take. Many of those policies evolved into actual laws that went through the legislature. So we took it through the committee process. And some of that stuff we codified into laws, especially in the healthcare industry, using telehealth. Or bringing in nurses from other states because of our shortage. We relied on out-of-state services. And so a lot of it was sort of that give and take through the executive order process, but then we put it into law. And I think, one of the areas as Republicans that we had pushed for is trying to create a more formal public hearing process so that when an executive order was proposed, we could hear from the general public to give us input when we're developing those rules so that we can be better off for it. And that didn't come to the very end of the process when we began voting.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was one of those damned if you do, damned if you don't type situations and trying to, it's really difficult to account for every kind of business environment and business climate that exists out there. So rather than go through the details of all of that, which is really difficult to do when we're kind of blanket policies, but you're right, determining that golf courses were deemed essential and they were allowed to remain open. There were a lot of people upset that we allowed golf courses to remain open and continue to operate. But you're outside, you're golfing, right? You're not really at risk of contracting COVID when you're out on a golf course. But the other one was package stores. Package stores were deemed to be essential and they were open throughout the pandemic. And it came in that those who work with individuals battling alcohol addiction, they made the argument that if you close these, you're actually going to force people who are grappling with that to perhaps turn to something far more dangerous to them and dangerous to the public, right? So they allowed package stores to be open, right? So there was a lot of information that was shared up at the governor's office, and I think they made as good decisions as they could. I think our preference is to allow businesses to operate as they normally do. I tend to trust most business owners that they care about their workers, that they care about their customers. And often in policymaking, we're often reacting to address the exceptions to some rule, right? So there are bad actors out there, there are bad business owners, there are bad employers who perhaps don't have the best interests of their employees or their customers at hand. Therefore, we have to act. But on the whole, most business owners are responsible, ethical people trying to do the right thing by their business and by their customers. But in a situation like we faced, in the interest of time, and if you can think back to what it felt like in March of 2020, April in 2020, it was just like every day we were waking up and it was just this crush of negative information out there on this unknown virus that was out there, right? I remember the first time I went in the grocery store, like in late March, I mean, you could feel the tension in the air. Everybody's kind of looking at each other like, you got it, right? It was a real difficult time for all of us as lawmakers and policymakers to try to do what we thought was best with the limited amount of information that we had at the time.
One of the interesting things, too, with the process is, you know, with the fear of the unknown impacting you is trying not to forget, you know, the parameters that we're allowed to operate under, you know, the Constitution. So when it came to businesses, there, you know, that was one area because it was interesting the debate that came to churches and whether or not churches can be open. And I remember reading one of those, the initial laws that came out for places of worship, and the state initially in a draft was banning the ability to receive the Eucharist. And as a practicing Catholic, that was a big deal for me, and I thought, you know, now we're getting into impacting the ability of free exercise of religion. And so it was an interesting debate that we ended up having with the governor's office. Is, you know, we can go this far, but we can't ban the ability for the Eucharist to be distributed. And so that actually impacted the decision. And we corrected it through drafts. But, you know, sort of remembering the framework that we have to operate under at the same time of trying to manage a pandemic, to me, like, was just really interesting looking back on it. It was a challenge.
My name is Lorraine Romero. I'm a student here at Eastern. The federal government has allocated infrastructure money to the state of Connecticut, and my question is how is that going to be dispersed?
That's a great issue. Is right now, you know, aside from the COVID money that we received and what was called the ARPA dollars that you hear about a lot in the news, that's creating a lot of the programs. We do have infrastructure money that's coming to the state of Connecticut, I think, over the course of the next 5 years. And how is that going to be administered? And I think the point I had made before, a lot of this, there are no strings attached. From a legislator standpoint, I think I could speak for both of us, it gets a little frustrating because the money comes in and the agencies spend a lot of this without our input. You know,
DOT is like the fifth branch of government,
right?
UConn and the original branches.
So in particular, there's a lot of money coming in, upward of from $4 to $6 billion of infrastructure money that the agency, the Department of Environmental Protection and Department of Transportation, those two agencies would have a lot of oversight. They'll apply for a lot of this money. And how is that going to happen? And so right now there is a Senate bill, I think it's 106, that's looking at what role could the legislature play in making sure that money gets spent sort of the way we want, you know, our input. And that's where it also gets interesting because we're treading on the separation of powers. So to what degree can the legislature step in and manage an agency, essentially? And so crafting legislation to have some level of oversight without the legislature taking over executive branch power is being debated, and it's something we're looking at. So for instance, we can try to create like a transportation strategy board that has legislative appointments, gubernatorial appointments, and maybe they serve as the body that would approve how this money is spent before the agency actually spends it. But right now, without any legislation, those decisions are really going to fall within the Department of Transportation and the Department of Environmental Protection, and it's going to really kind of circumvent the legislative process.
Yeah, I mean, the Department of Transportation has a $100 billion list of projects that they would like to get funded and work on, so it's a matter of prioritizing what can be moved most quickly. And keep in mind, DOT is facing staffing issues too and retention issues too. There are not enough engineers in the world as of today, and we're certainly expecting not to have enough of them over the next 5 to 10 years when a lot of this money actually gets implemented. It was just an article, I think, over the past weekend, how, you know, the Department of Transportation is expecting a wave of retirements, just like the entire state of Connecticut is, before June 30th of this year. We don't know how many of those are going to be Department of Transportation employees. And, you know, everybody thinks about transportation in terms of people with the, you know, orange jackets on the highway, laying down pavement. But before you even get to that, there's about 10 to 20 years of work on environmental impact, on design, on redesigning a design, all those types of things. I often use the Aetna Viaduct in Hartford, which is the elevated highway that goes through Hartford. It's about 20 years past its useful life. It's probably going to cost $10 to $15 billion just that two-mile stretch alone to replace. And that's just one two-mile stretch in the state of Connecticut. And there are dozens or hundreds of projects just like that all over the state that require a lot of time and funding. I think about the Q Bridge in New Haven. That project was started in 1989. They cut the ribbon on it like 3 years ago. That's how long I think we all take for granted. We drive over bridges, we drive over highways, they just get built. But they are often 10 and 20 years in the making before we actually are able to take a drive over that bridge.
Hello, my name is Ari Greenman. I'm a political science major here at Eastern. I know you just spoke about transportation, and I was just wondering what your plans are financially for the train stations across the state, as well as Bradley International Airport, which I think is it's the second largest airport in New England, and I think that it has a lot of potential opportunity for more international flights in the future, and I just want to see what your thoughts are on that and how to make Connecticut a bigger market to really not just the United States, but the world as a whole.
Yeah, I think one of the areas, and I'm biased because I live outside New Haven County, but as infrastructure money comes in, focusing on the train from New York City to New Haven is one of the areas we should be focusing on. I think in the late 80s, it was quicker to get to New York City than it is today because of our aging infrastructure with our bridges. The trains have to slow down so much now that it actually takes longer to get from New York City from New Haven. And so those infrastructure dollars, I would hope, will be used for that area in particular, because to me it is one of our economic engines, for the state of Connecticut. You know, Bradley itself, it has sort of its own authority that manages that airport. The state of Connecticut, certainly we do support it, and we recognize the commercial, the economy that's driven and helped out by Bradley Airport just for that and for recreation, for people to go on trips. The big debate right now in Hartford is Brainerd Airport, which there is debate up in Hartford of whether or not we should be closing Brainerd Airport. And it's kind of an interesting issue because nobody really hears of Brainerd. It's not a commercial airport where people will fly in and out. They do a lot of training there. Training of our pilots, fixing of aircraft, and there's other type of economic support that they provide the whole region. And so I think that's going to be a real hot debate this year is, as we're looking at redevelopment, is that an airport that should be taken away? And I know there's studies that the state has done in the past on it, but that will probably be a real hot topic this session.
Yeah, I mean, I think, Bradley has improved exponentially over the last 10 to 20 years. I often joke, the first time I ran for office for the state legislature, I had invested in Bradley International Airport, invested in our ports. I didn't really know what I was talking about at the time. I just thought those were good ideas because I'm a policy geek. Really had nothing to do with my district. But it's great to see where Bradley has gone. I think it's one of the best airports to fly in and out of. One of the challenges are the limited direct flights that I think people prefer, but we're actually starting to see a lot of those come online too. There's a lot of new airlines that are setting up shop at Bradley, so I think we're already heading in the direction of that being a far more customer-friendly type of airport. There's already a lot of heavy warehouse and shipping, UPS, FedEx, Amazon building gigantic warehouses, obviously in close proximity to the airport. I think one of the big questions now is do we have a direct rail line to the airport, and that isn't in the works right now, going up through Windsor Locks and then heading over on buses to Bradley so that individuals can take a train up to the airport. But there also has to be demand for it, right? We are a very car-centric state, car-centric mentality in our state. Public transportation is not something as robust as I think it could be given our proximity to New York. I mean, it's obviously different down in Fairfield County with Metro North being there, but even as people begin to work more from home, you know, what's that going to mean for Metro North and that rail line? And more people are working from home and not going back and forth to New York.
I just had a pretty general question about criminal justice policy. In the last few years, I know that crimes among younger people have increased a lot, especially juvenile justice, and I just wanted to know kind of what your guys' thoughts were on some of the legislative and social causes of that, and if there's any legislation or just ideas on how to combat that issue.
Yeah, I think that's it. Yeah, that's a great issue that certainly has a lot of controversy in Hartford. Over the years, there's been a lot of changes that Connecticut's made to its criminal justice reform. A lot of the changes I had voted for. One of the things I think that we're seeing, and whatever the cause is, whether it's you know COVID or just certain changes, we're seeing sort of in the suburbs, a lot of people are talking about the proliferation of car thefts, you know, and it started out there and it sort of evolved. I think one of my concerns right now is we've taken a lot of discretion away from the courts and police officers in how to handle certain situations. And I think we've got to look at that of allowing, for instance, a juvenile to be detained for more than 6 hours if they've been taken into custody. To be able to evaluate them for services and also determine if they're a danger to themselves or to the public. Right now under Connecticut state law, after 6 hours, they're released no matter what, even if they don't have a parent. Now the police can apply for an extension beyond the 6 hours, but we're not sure they're not applying for that. So we're trying to figure out why, and we're collecting some data on that issue. And also under some circumstances, you know, when should a child or a young adult, I say under the age of 18, when should a crime trigger a transfer to adult court? Right now, the way the laws have been changed, it's very difficult that a juvenile would ever be transferred and tried in adult court for a crime that they've committed. And then the last piece, sort of the concern, I think what we see is that there is a level of recidivism occurring because there's no consequences to their actions. So I was at a school for that dealt with teens that get expelled, and they work with the teens. And the teachers have said to me, it's very difficult for us right now because we try to teach them cause and effect and consequences to your actions. And if there are no consequences to individuals that get caught breaking into a vehicle, how do we correct that behavior? And I think that's something that we need to take a look at. And so it's definitely an issue that is going to be it's always been a political football right now in the legislature. And I'm sure we're going to see some reforms coming out of the Judiciary Committee this year.
Yeah, no, I think there are definitely areas of agreement. We've heard that, again, this has been a process in which the chair of the Judiciary Committee, the chairs of Judiciary are Democrats, the ranking members are obviously Republican. They've spent a lot of time with each other, listening to each other, talking to each other, don't always come to agreement, but there is a lot of, I think, listening and potential agreement that can be reached. We're certainly not willing to go as far as some of our colleagues on the other side of the aisle would like us to go. We're hesitant, particularly as a person of color. I'm hesitant to go back to this get tough on crime approach because we saw how that ended up for people of color, in particular for young people of color. And if you listen to most police chiefs, they will say, we're talking about a very small fraction of youth in my community who are committing most of the crimes. Except when we change these laws to be tougher on crime, they end up capturing much more than just that small group of youth who are actually committing the crime. We end up actually impacting a lot of individuals who otherwise made a mistake as a young person. And probably everybody in this room has done that. Maybe you've been lucky and don't live in a community that's over-policed. Maybe you went to school where you get in a fight in school, they don't have you arrested, perhaps they have you suspended, or they call mom or dad. That doesn't happen across our communities. So that's why there's a hesitancy to go back to. And actually, if you look at it nationally, conservatives and liberals have been coming around criminal justice reform, and that's why Ben even talked about, he's voted for a lot of these criminal justice reforms, but there's also room for improvement, right? There is something not right when you have a young person who is committing a crime 5 or 6 or 7 times, and still somehow end up being out in the street. It's clear a child is in crisis and they need something, whether it's rehabilitation through the criminal justice system, or mental health services, or whatever it is, or they've experienced family trauma. We are not meeting that need, and that's what we are failing as a state. I don't know that the being tougher on crime is going to result in the kind of outcomes that people hope for or wish for. Often when we send a young person off to be incarcerated, they come out a better criminal. And I don't think that's better for all of us in the long run, because that's not the point of our system. The point of our system is rehabilitation. And right now, we don't provide educational services to those young people. We don't provide adequate mental health counseling to those individuals while they're incarcerated. And that's why we kind of have the recidivism that we do have.
And I think two areas too, I think that we could probably look at. When an individual is arrested, their whole records aren't necessarily taken into consideration when they're brought into custody. So it's a sharing of data. You know, if you see somebody who has been arrested 20 times and has a pending docket, maybe that is an individual that we should be looking at and saying, you know, this person just shouldn't be released, they need more help. Whether it's services or whether it's incarceration, but because I think we all do recognize that there is a level of recidivism, that the same individuals are the ones that are committing these crimes. The other piece I think we should look at is when we close the detention center in Middletown. I think that was in the bipartisan budget that we had voted for, but that's an area that I question whether that was the best decision we ever made, because it was an institution that provided the services, education, mental health treatment, that fairly got criticism in some cases of how the youth were treated. But the way we addressed it in Connecticut, we shut the whole system down and didn't replace it with anything else. And so what happened in the short run is children that were getting into trouble were just being put into group homes through DCF that don't have the services that they may have needed.
Or security.
That's right, or security. So I think those are some other areas that we have to look at.
Yeah, my name is Dan Deere. I'm a philosophy student here, so please stop me if I start to ramble. My question pertains to public education, which you've brought up a couple of times. You both expressed opinions on the value of critical thinking skills. My question is, do you believe that the state adequately prepares citizens in the course of primary education to exercise those critical thinking skills? Is this something that is the realm of higher education to instill in students, or is it the job of these types of institutions to teach more specialized skills where primary education should be responsible for the general ability of citizens?
I don't think you can get the higher ed without an adequate K-12 system, right? And we've seen that here in Connecticut, where, at least in the community college system, where almost 70% of the students who are matriculating into those schools needed to take a remedial course in either English or math. So clearly we're not preparing them enough, or they're not leaving high school prepared enough, because I do think we do a good job of providing an opportunity to learn. It really comes down to the individual and how much they're willing to take advantage of the public opportunity that's been given to them to receive a really great education. You know, you can receive that education in a high-resource community, and certainly it's harder in an under-resourced community, but you can still attain it. And I guess that's shaped by my personal experience of growing up low-income, growing up poor, growing up in a situation where neither of my parents spoke English, or my dad had a third-grade education, yet I had the opportunity. And I think it was my parents moving out of Hartford, right, to a community where there was less poverty, because even the best teachers in the world can't address the needs of all 25 children who are in front of them who are coming from a background of poverty. It is just really difficult to do. So when you deconcentrate that poverty, I think there are opportunities for kids like me to take advantage of the opportunities that are presented to them and end up sitting before you with the fancy title that I have today.
Yeah, and I do think it's developed, you know, at a young age in the school system. And I think that the critical thinking is important for for anyone to go through. You know, we hear a lot right now in education institutions are under attack. And I think one of the biggest flaws right now we've heard about, you know, is CRT being taught in schools. And in my local community in Guilford, that became a very huge issue that people ran on. What is being taught in school and what is acceptable? And I think part of the issue is that you know, making sure that we're giving children the tools to be able to critically think, you know, as opposed to teaching them just certain perspectives. You know, I think to high school now, when I went to school, you never knew your teacher's, you know, political leanings. But we've sort of loosened some of those standards, and I think students and teachers end up getting debates, and it ends up turning into, in particular, Republican, Democrat, as opposed to the issue at hand, you know, the particular labels we get caught up in, you know, as opposed to focusing on the actual topics. And I think, you know, the institutions can do a better job generally, I think, if we pull away from that and really stay focused on those issues. And also, I think COVID has impacted that as well, because parents aren't in the schools as much, so we don't have that level of interaction with our teachers that we had before. So getting a little bit off the topic of the original question, but in Torrington, they're debating whether or not to take cell phones away from the kids in school. And there's debate over, you know, I was watching a show where they said even the parents are texting and calling their kids, you know, in school. But I think that happened really out of COVID. My youngest is a junior, and I probably do communicate with her through texting while she's in school, but I was thinking about it. I've never set foot in the high school to visit her or her teachers since COVID began in 2020. And I think that sort of has exacerbated and changed, you know, how children are learning and what level of parental involvement is there. So it's led to a lot of other things. So I think, you know, it is important to make sure those components are there, but it's interesting to watch sort of the focus now that we're seeing being turned onto our school systems. And in part, I think, you know, it's probably the one area that was most adversely impacted by COVID was our schools. And you know, it's going to take some time, I think, to sort of try to normalize it.
Everyone needs to read more, I think.
Yeah.
Not to oversimplify, but everybody needs to read more.
All right, we're going to start wrapping up in a few minutes. If anyone else has some final questions, feel free to go up right now. Anybody? All right, so it looks like we're good. Thank you guys so much for coming. I hope all of the guests in attendance took something from this, and it can help kind of inform your decisions coming up in this year's elections. In November, there are elections and a number of seats in different. I believe there's some seats up in the.
We're all up in the legislature. Yeah, and all the constitutional offices are up this year too. So
I hope that some of these topics talked about kind of affect your decision making in your voting this year. And